Welcome to NIO's studio. Myself, Dr. Babita Parashar, Head Department of Education, Manav Rachna University, Faridabad. Today, we are going to study together assessment of personality projective techniques. But before we begin with what projective techniques are, we need to once understand what personality is. Now, personality for each of us, it is the first impression we make of a person. We meet so many people in a classroom, at a railway station, in the market we go, in our school setups, in the meetings, conferences, anywhere we go, we meet so many people, and for each person we make an impression, and that impression we assume is the personality. But Allport, a very famous psychologist, said that personality is not the first impression which we make. It is the dynamic organization within the individual of those psychophysical systems that determine his characteristic behavior and thought. Now, in this entire definition, for us to understand personality better, I've picked up some keywords. So the first keyword which I've picked up is dynamic. Now, dynamic is something which is undergoing changes at a regular interval. Like, for example, I met somebody today, I meet the same person few years later, there is a lot of difference which I'm able to figure out. The voice has changed, the confidence has changed, the dressing sense has changed, the thought process has changed, the beliefs have changed. So the personality, the first personality image which I hold of that person of a few months back has undergone changes based on what all the person was being exposed to. So personality is dynamic. It is not only the physical appearance, it is also the psychological aspects which make a person's personality. So psycho as well as physical, they together constitute the personality of a person, which is reflected in the form of behavior and the thought process. So in all, dynamic psychophysical organization of behavior and thought constitute the personality of a person. Now, why we are here to assess personality, why we cannot measure it? So to measure something, there has to be an object, like this is an apple, this is sugar, this is cloth, this is milk. So anything to be measured has to have a concrete shape which is identifiable. Personality is not a thing. To measure something, again, we have to have an instrument. There has to be a measuring balance. Like if I wish to know what is my weight, I will stand on a weighing balance. So there has to be some zero weight. So in reference to that zero weight, my weight would reflect on the weighing balance. There is no instrument by which we can measure personality. Again, the person who will do the measurement, whoever measure. If I'm measuring cloth, I'll measure it 1 meter. My neighbor measures 1 meter. The shopkeeper measures 1 meter. So it is not affected by who is doing the measurement. And personality does depend on the person who is doing the evaluation. So based on these three characteristics, we cannot measure personality. We can only assess it because it is dynamic. Now, again, just to recall what we have said, that whenever you say that I want to measure this, you have an object, a picture of the object. You also have a picture of the instrument to be used and the person who will do it. All these three are not applicable in case of personality. So personality is to be assessed, not to be measured. Personality is not a thing, it is an idea. Psychologists have different opinion about dimensions and content. Few traits are superior for one psychologist, few are superior for the other one. So what it actually constitutes of is still debatable. And then it is not static, it is dynamic. So how will you measure something which is changing after some intervals of time? The nature of the instrument, there is no zero, there is no starting point for reference that this personality is a zero personality and beyond that we will start measuring. Even a newborn baby has a personality. So the images which you see on the screen, the measuring tape, the measuring cylinder, the weighing balance, each of them have the reference zero. So with reference to that zero, we measure, which is not applicable to personality. And there is no reliable scale or instrument of measure. So after all these initial discussions, we at least agree that why we are studying here, the assessment of personality, not measurement of personality. The techniques. So now something which is to be assessed, there has to be assessment techniques which are there. So for assessment of personality, there can be non-projective techniques or they can be projective techniques. In our former session, we have already studied non-projective techniques in detail. We'll be talking about the projective techniques in this particular session. The projective techniques are indirect methods of personality assessment, which focus on the subconscious mind. The techniques allow the teacher or the researcher to tap into subjects' deep motivations, beliefs, hidden emotions, attitudes, desires, internal conflicts, the value system. When we talk about the projective techniques, as a human being, I have this strong inhibition that I would only portray the desirable part of my personality. But when we use the projective techniques through ambiguous images, situations, sentences, we are trying to assess all these features or the traits of personality without the subject being identifying that by addressing to these particular techniques, how he or she is projecting the personality of herself or himself. The projective techniques for personality assessment, which we'll be focused in this particular session, are these five techniques. The first one is a very popular technique, which is the Rorschach ink blot test. The second is the word association test, popularly known as VAT, thematic apperception test, TAT, sentence completion test, and child apperception test, which is a form of thematic apperception test, but designed for the children. When we'll be studying these techniques in detail, we would understand that why TAT was not applicable to children between age group of 5 to 8 years. So for them, a parallel test with the same objective was being designed, and it was named as children apperception test. We come down to the first technique, which is Rorschach ink blot test. Now Hermann Rorschach created the Rorschach ink blot test in 1921. It consists of 10 bilaterally symmetrical ink blots printed in separate sheets. Now, by bilaterally symmetrical, I mean that we take a sheet of paper or a chart paper and you put some ink on that. You fold it and open it back. Now, these two marks which are left on the sheet are symmetrical to each other, like your mirror image. If you see your image in a mirror, the two are identical, two are superimposable. Like if you move towards the mirror, your nose will bang opposite the nose. Your forehead will bang opposite the forehead. So that is what we mean by a bilaterally symmetrical or a mirror image. So the Rorschach ink blot test is consisting of 10 such sheets. The entire 10 sheets are divided into three slots. The first one are the five achromatic without color ink blots, which are only in black and white. The next three sheets, the next two sheets are two in color, which is they are made up of black, red and white, and the last three cards are multicolored. So in all, these are the color patterns which are being designed, and all the ink blots are ambiguous. It only depends upon how a person or the subject is interpreting it. Now, I will take you through not all 10 sheets of them, but I'll show you some sheets. So when one sheet is being shown or one card is being shown to a subject, he or she is given the liberty to take as much time as the candidate wish to. There is no time limit. The subject can hold the card in any direction they wish to. Like if you are holding it in this direction, the subject is free to hold it upside down, inverted, anywhere whichever gives him a good perspective, the subject is allowed that freedom to do that. So these are some of the cards which we just talk about. Now once I'm taking you through these cards, you can also do that small drill that once you look at the image, you would help me that what do you see in that image and which part of the image you focus. So these are the some cards which I'm taking you through. This is another card, next one of them. As I said, there are only red, black and whites, two cards. There are some cards, 5 of them, which are only black and white, and there are 3 cards which are multicolored, which you can see while I'm taking you through these cards also. These are the cards, the multicolored ones. I took you through these cards, but as a teacher or as a researcher, when you will administer the RoSARC ink blot test, you'll do it in 2 phases. The first phase is the free association phase. In that first phase or the free association phase, as a teacher, you'll show one card to the subject at a time. So once that card is being projected, you will ask that what might this be? Why you will ask what might this be? Because they're very ambiguous. So it is just a perspective which will help the subject decide that what is being seen. So the first phase is the free association phase, where the card is projected and the subject answers that what might this be. And the second phase of the same is the inquiry phase, that you as a researcher or as a teacher ask that which feature of the ink blot played key role in the percept. The percept is the perception of an image. Like if I take you back these cards, like if this card is there, so once the child has shared with you the percept, you as a teacher would inquire further that what has led to you, which part of this image you focused, and why this. So it is an animal image, it is a human image, it is some part of the human image or the animal image, it is living, it is non-living, it is clouds, you can see it is as a wall from where the paint has been chipped off. So then as a researcher or as a teacher, you will inquire further to know that how that percept was being formed. So this is it. Then how will you score the responses? These are the 4 basic areas where you will focus on. First is the location. The second is the contents, originality, and determinants. So these are the basic scoring areas where you as a do it. RoSARC ink blot test is a standardized test. These are the kits available with all the administering rules. So lot of training need to be required at the level of the teacher or researcher to use it effectively. Now the second projective technique which we come down to is the word association test. Contrast to the RoSARC ink blot test, where we were giving ample time. By ample, I mean as much time as the subject wished to take. As a researcher or as a teacher, you will give them. But when it comes to the word association test, it's a rapid fire response. Like you will give one word and immediately the respondent should reply. So maybe like for 2 seconds, you will display the word, and then maybe next 2 seconds, you will give them to come down to. So the moment the teacher says mother, immediately the first thing which comes to the mind of the subject, they need to respond: marriage, happiness, money. So since there is no time being given to think or to frame or to cook an answer, the first response which comes out in the word association test would help the researcher or the teacher to have a very fair idea of it. But yes, the time need to be monitored very strictly. The thematic apperception test, the next test in the projective category. The Henry Murray in 1943 gave the thematic apperception test. When TAT was being designed, it was basically designed to know the level of aspiration or achievement in a subject. But later on, by the kind of responses which were being received for TAT on the subjects which it was administered, it was applied or administered for the thorough assessment of a personality. Now, what instructions are to be given to the subject? I'll also share with you the various cards of TAT. The first is that what is going on in the picture? The TAT is comprised of the situations from a real life. These are the situations which me, you, your neighbor, any acquaintance, they have come across. But when the test is administered, what do we make out of it? How do we identify ourselves with the picture or the protagonist is the entire game which is there. So we ask the subject that what is going on in the picture, what led to this scene, and what would likely happen to in this situation. Now, these are the some of the pictures which have been taken from TAT. The TAT comprised of the 30 pictures, which are the real situations. As you can see in these two, if you see them as a respondent, so it is subject subconsciously reveals his or her own personality. Like if we focus on picture one, we can see in the background it is a farm. So there is an old lady standing and there is a young lady which is there. Now if it is being administered on adolescence age group, the candidate would identify himself or herself as someone who's ambitious, who doesn't wish to go back to farming because he has seen his parents toiling hard, still the father being suiciding because of the loans and everything. So although the subject would not know, but when all the 30 cards are being administered, subconsciously they will be able to identify themselves with the situations and they will be able to express them in terms of their hidden emotions, attributes, aspirations, dreams, motivations. So as a teacher, you would be able to identify the aspiration level of the subject. The same in the second picture also. The next test which is being done in the projective technique category is the sentence completion test. The sentences which are being used here, there it can be a variety of sentences. There are some tests which are standardized sentence completion tests, which are given across the world as a by different psychologists. We can also have our own sentence completion test based on the group which we are dealing with, the kind of challenges you are feeling with the group, and then you can do the personality assessment. Like if I read out the sentence, I like to. So if the candidate is undergoing a lot of peer pressure, the child might able to wish to complete the sentence, I like to run away from my classroom. My childhood has been beautiful. The other child, my childhood has been adventurous. My childhood has been struggling. My childhood has been a fairy tale. So every time a different respondent answer a question, they will talk about what they have gone through, because you are not giving them a lot of time to cook the answers. I often dream of living in a villa. I often dream of a air journey. I often dream of seeing myself on a TV screen. So through these answers or sentence completion test, I'm able to know that what are the hidden emotions in my classroom. And then on the basis of them, I might be able to counsel them for the skills they opt for. Like if I've always dreamt of looking beautiful, so maybe this is the group who will be more equipped for a beauty industry as a skill training technique. So these sentence completion tests talk a lot about the personality of the class you're dealing with. I'm worried over my father's health. I'm worried over my brother's education. I'm worried over my principal's transfer. I'm worried over my early marriage. My hero is my father. My hero is my brother. My hero is Narendra Modi. Through all these answers or sentence completion test, as a teacher, you are able to know the personality traits of a class, and then also the hidden emotions, the challenges, the inhibitions, the motives, and it helps a lot a teacher to take their class in the right direction. The child apperception test, as I shared in the beginning slides, it was being given by Leopold Balak and Sonia Soar L. Balak, the couple, in 1949. Now this couple was parent of a couple of children, and then they always felt that each child was special in his or her own ways. Although they were giving the same kind of parenting to each child, but they were being shaped or groomed in different directions. Motivated by that, these parents came up with a child apperception test. This the child apperception test is parallel to TAT, the thematic apperception test, which we just talked about, the real life situations, ambiguous ones, and the and the subject identifies and expresses. The same way in the child apperception test, the cards are more about the animal figures, because in the age group of 5 to 8 years, the children are basically in a fantasy world. So they read fables, they know that rabbits can fly, they know that a bear can talk. So based on all those situations, this couple designed the child apperception test. I'll share with you some of the slides of them. So these are the slides. So if you see the first slide, which is about our chicken family. Now, if the child is being asked to write a story on the first picture, and the child identifies himself as a part of a happy, healthy family, they'll talk about the mother feeding the children, it is the siblings or it is the cousin, or if the child is the only child, so they might also express that my neighbor's family have three children, they all eat together, the mother feeds them all together, but it is not so in my case. So that is why that is how you can come to know that the child is very lonely at home and it's striving for a group of a similar age band. And then in the next picture, if we see, so there is a lion who is sitting on a chair. The walking stick shows that it is getting old and needs some support. So maybe the child would identify the lion with the grandfather, with a lot of time which is required. So this is child apperception test. We'll have a quick recap. In this particular session, we studied about personality, that how it is dynamic, psychophysical, and behavior traits, how being a part of it, why it cannot be measured but assessed, because it is not a thing, there is no instrument to measure it, and the various projective techniques which we talked about. So thank you for being with me in this session, and happy learning.